high school, your children, lunch hour is over.
Your attention, colleagues.
Colleagues, it's an honor for me to introduce our next guest and our friend. Professor Maria de la Luz Arriaga teaches in the Faculty of Economics at UNAM, the National University in Mexico City, which is the largest in Latin America. As a volunteer, Professor Arriaga, our good friend, Mary Luz, has been the coordinator of the Mexican section of the Tri-National Coalition in Defense of Public Education from its beginning 20 years ago. The BCTF has been an active participant in the coalition as well since it was formed when the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, came into effect in 1994. The Tri-National has been an important link of the BCTF with our colleagues in Mexico, building connections that would not have been possible without the work of Mary Luz. Teachers in Mexico face many of the problems that we have, but in more extreme forms. And the Tri-National has provided an opportunity to provide that national that mutual support in our struggles. During our strike in 2005, which I've mentioned earlier, it was Mary Luz who organized a demonstration in support of us, the BCTF, at the Canadian Embassy in Mexico City. And when it appeared that the courts might stop us from using our website for communicating with our members, she and other colleagues created a website that we would be able to use if ours was shut down. So please join me in welcoming our good friend of the BCTF and BC teachers, Mary Luz, and Steve Stewart will be interpreting for her.
Compañeros y compañeras, hermanos, hermanas, brothers and sisters. Antes de empezar mi presentación, quiero decirles que me siento muy honrada en estar en esta asamblea con todas y todos ustedes y que me enorgullece también llamarlos hermanos, hermanas de lucha. Ser hermano o hermana es una circunstancia aleatoria, biológica, que uno no escoge, pero ser hermanos y hermanas de lucha, si lo escogemos y lo construimos. Gracias por darme esta oportunidad de estar con ustedes.
Colleagues, brothers and sisters, before beginning my presentation, I just want to underscore how honored I feel to be able to share this assembly with you. And the pride I feel in being able to call you all brothers and sisters of the struggle. Being a brother or a sister is a biological thing. You don't get to choose your brother or sister, but you do get to choose your brothers and sisters in the struggle. And Mary Luz says she feels she's chosen very well in working with all of the members of the BCTF.
Voy a hablar de la experiencia de construcción de la Coalición Trinacional en Defensa de la Educación Pública, de 20 años de lucha compartida, de 20 años de solidaridad, pero no de solidaridad asistencial o de los fuertes para los débiles. Voy a hablar de la construcción de un programa común, de estrategias compartidas, de acciones de apoyo que van desde cartas de solidaridad, asistencia y organización de foros, la realización de 11 conferencias trinacionales. Bueno, 10 y la próxima es en Chicago en mayo y espero que todos ustedes vayan. Voy a hablar también de la publicación de revistas, de folletos, de actos en las embajadas o consulados demandando solución a las exigencias de las y los trabajadores de la educación.
I am going to speak of the experience of the construction of the Tri-National Coalition in Defense of Public Education, of 20 years of shared struggle, 20 years of solidarity, but not a charitable model of solidarity, not assistentialist solidarity of the strong to the weak. I'm going to speak of the construction of a common program, of shared strategies, of actions of support that go from letters of solidarity, financial support, to the organization of forums, to carrying out of 11 tri-national conferences, well, actually 10, because the 11th one will be taking place in May in Chicago, the publication of magazines on education struggles, of information pamphlets, of actions in at embassies or consulates demanding a solution to people's demands.
Y de cómo la coalición trinacional se convirtió en un puente para vincular las luchas de los trabajadores y las trabajadoras de la educación de Estados Unidos y Canadá con América Latina, creando la red social para la educación pública en las Américas.
And I'm also going to speak about how the Tri-National Coalition became a bridge to link labor organizations, teachers' organizations in the United States and Canada with the rest of Latin America, but through the creation of the Initiative for Democratic Education in the Americas, the IDEA Network.
En algunas de las diapositivas que están pasando ahora, ustedes verán que se muestran actividades que hemos desarrollado a lo largo de estos años.
In some of the images at the back, they don't completely follow the speech, but some of the images you'll see of the kind of work that's been done by the IDEA Network and the Tri-National Coalition over the past 20 years.
Con la coalición trinacional en defensa de la educación pública y el estrecho apoyo de la Federación de Columbia, de Profesores de Columbia Británica, hemos formado una colaboración solidaria que contribuye a avanzar en los procesos de lucha y a cambiar la correlación de fuerzas nacionales e internacionales. Ustedes se preguntarán, ¿cómo es esto?
Through the Tri-National Coalition to Defend Public Education, and with the close support of the BC Teachers Federation, we've formed a collective collaboration that's contributed to advancing the struggles for teachers' rights and for public education, and has, through this work, changed the correlation of forces at the national level and the international level. So the question comes up of how could such a thing happen? How could these relatively small organizations change the correlation of forces in the respective countries?
Como sabemos y como lo sufrimos todos y todas, las políticas internacionales que se generan en educación, en salud, que arrasan derechos sociales, están diseñadas por organismos internacionales y los gobiernos y las corporaciones que ejercen el poder a través de ellos son quienes se reúnen y las pactan. Y nunca habíamos imaginado hasta dónde iban a llegar, despojando derechos laborales. ¿Cuándo se imaginaron ustedes que en Canadá, un país que se precia de respetar la legalidad, se atacara a la Federación de Maestros de Columbia Británica en el 2002 para despojarla de la posibilidad de pactar su contrato colectivo y así imponerles grupos muy numerosos o eliminar la posibilidad de la revisión salarial?
So as we know, and as we have suffered, all of us, the kind of policies around healthcare and education, the push for privatization, for businessization, I guess is the translation, of these social rights, is something that is not something that simply occurs to governments in our own countries. It's something that is developed at the international level and then brought down to the national level by the various governments that are charged with expressing them. And so often what happens in one country is later manifest in the various other countries. And in the past decade and a half, we've really seen the strong thrust of these international policies. Who would have imagined 15 years ago that in a country like Canada that had an international reputation for its respect for due process in the law, that a government would so blatantly violate international law with such things as the bills brought down on the BC Teachers Federation in 2002, eliminating basic social rights, eliminating the right to negotiate working and learning conditions.
¿Cuándo se imaginarían ustedes que en un país como México, su gobierno iba a seguir la misma pauta que en Columbia Británica? Porque a nosotros, el año 2013, se nos cambió nuestra constitución para obligar a los maestros a una evaluación, mal llamada evaluación, porque es medición estandarizada, periódica cada 4 años, y si los profesores no pasan por 2 ocasiones consecutivas el examen que fijan en base a recomendaciones de la Organización para la Cooperación y el Desarrollo Económico, van a ser despedidos.
And similarly in Mexico, we never imagined that in 2013, a government would alter the Constitution, would reform the Constitution specifically to target teachers, to take away rights of teachers. But that happened just last year when the Constitution was altered in such a way to take away the sort of guarantee of the state nature of education and to require teachers to be submitted every 4 years to standardized exams that every teacher has to sit. And if they do not pass in 2 consecutive sittings, that they are required to be fired from their jobs. And the content of these exams, again, not designed at the national level, but developed within the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, a sort of multinational organization of companies in the wealthy countries.
Estas políticas son mundiales y nosotros podemos ver claramente que lo que buscan no solo es atacar a los sindicatos, buscan atacar a las y los maestros. Tratan de presentarnos como rijosos, problemáticos, como profesores que no queremos evaluarnos, como profesores que tenemos saberes obsoletos. Si no sabemos manejar la última generación de las nuevas tecnologías de la información y la comunicación, nuestros saberes parece que ya no sirven. Así nos tratan de presentar en los medios de comunicación. Estoy hablando de México, pero estoy segura que aquí también, en Canadá, tratan de responsabilizar a las maestras y a los maestros de los problemas educativos.
And so this sort of offensive against teachers and against public education is a global phenomena. And it's something that we're seeing, the way it's manifested in Mexico, and Marilu says she imagines that you'll see some familiarity of this here, is through such things as these exams and through declarations to the media, coverage of teachers, it's not an attempt simply to confront the teachers' unions, but to confront teachers themselves, to disqualify teachers, to make teachers seem like they're the cause of the problems, the prime cause of problems in education, that they're too rigid, that their knowledge is obsolete, that because they don't know the latest wave in new communications technology, the knowledge that they have is no longer relevant. So this is the kind of message that's being pushed out in Mexico as a way to both undermine not just the teachers' organizations, but teachers themselves and the validity of public education.
Lo que la coalición trinacional en defensa de la educación pública nos ha permitido, al igual que la red social para la educación pública en las Américas, es conocer, prever qué va a pasar. Y compañeros y compañeras, quiero decirles que en mi universidad, la universidad más importante de México y una de las mejores de América Latina, en este momento quieren imponer programas que les llaman de renovación de la planta docente, en donde las plazas de tiempo completo van a ser para profesores, hombres de no más de 37 años y mujeres de no más de 39 años.
So these are the kinds of things that through the work in the Trinational Coalition and through the IDEA Network, we've been able to see them sort of coming down the pipeline, because they're usually tried out in one country before they're then replicated, or they attempt to replicate them in other countries. And it helps us learn from the strategies of our colleagues in the other countries what worked to help resist them. In the case of Mariluz's own university, the largest and one of the most prestigious public universities in Latin America, one new thing that's coming through that she, it's more relevant to post-secondary, but she sort of setting the alarm on, is they've adopted a new policy that's called renovation that doesn't allow a granting of tenureship to anyone exceeding 37 years of age. With the idea that we only want young with it professors coming in.
Quieren ponernos a pelear a profesores jóvenes con profesores viejos.
And this also serves to sort of try and foment a conflict, a lack of unity, conflict between older professors and younger ones.
Pero esto no es solo lo que nos ha permitido la coalición, es conocer hacia dónde se dirigen, cuál es el horizonte de las corporaciones y sus gobiernos en cuanto al control de los maestros, las maestras, el ataque a las organizaciones. Afortunadamente, la coalición también nos ha permitido encontrarnos, conocernos y unirnos.
And so, we sort of, one of the mechanisms of the Trinational Coalition and the IDEA Network is to look out on the horizon. What's coming down? What's coming to us? Sometimes even before it starts getting implemented in countries. And it also gives us a chance to get to know each other, to learn about each other's struggles, but also our methods of organization in a way that we feel a much closer bond and a need to work together and support one another.
Y esto nos fortalece, nos convierte en elementos fundamentales de la transformación a nivel general.
And this strengthens us, and it converts us into becoming fundamental actors in the struggle at a continental or hemispheric level for the public education.
Los procesos de solidaridad que hemos desarrollado no se dan solo entre el Ejecutivo de la Federación de Profesores de Columbia Británica o de Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation o de Chicago Union Teachers o de secciones en México del Magisterio Democrático de sindicatos universitarios. Se da a nivel también de bases. Hemos tenido eventos, foros donde ha habido maestros de Oaxaca electos en sus comunidades en un número de 2,500 acudiendo a un foro para poder entender qué pasa con la evaluación estandarizada.
And an important aspect of this model that makes this kind of model of solidarity somewhat distinct is it's not simply a model of the elect, a solidarity of the elected representatives of each organization communicating with one another, but one that goes further down to the classroom teacher, to the membership. Whether it's solidarity with the BCTF, with the Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation, with the Chicago Teachers Union, or with the democratic sections within the Mexican movement. There's mobilization and support at the executive level, but there's also a lot of events that involve membership. One example that Marluce wanted to illustrate was something that the IDEA Network carried out, an international seminar on the impact of standardized evaluation on education and alternatives being developed in countries to it, that started out as an international seminar, but then was carried to Oaxaca, where each community teachers group elected a representative, and 2,500 teachers from Oaxaca participated in the forum on experiences in multiple countries of the impact of standardized evaluation.
¿Cuál es la importancia entonces de estos procesos de solidaridad? ¿Y qué nos aportan? ¿Qué le aportan a la Federación de Profesores de Columbia Británica? ¿Qué nos aportan a los profesores de América Latina? Lo primero es que la Federación de Profesores de Columbia Británica tiene una definición muy clara de sí misma y que yo creo que debería de ser ejemplo de muchas federaciones y sindicatos en el mundo.
So what are the benefits to the individual organizations of developing relations of solidarity like that? How does that benefit the BCTF? How does that benefit the various teachers unions in Mexico or the ones that belong in the United States? One of them that Marie-Luce would like to underscore is that the BCTF, in terms of the teachers organizations that participate, has a very clear idea of its own role in society.
La definición que tiene la Federación de Profesores de Columbia Británica es el de ser una organización que busca y construye en la acción para la justicia social. Esto es muy importante. No es solo luchar por mejores salarios, por mejores condiciones de trabajo, sino por una transformación de la sociedad en donde haya justicia y condiciones igualitarias. Y esto es muy preciado por nosotros.
Something that's very important. Wow, there's a lot of Spanish speakers here. something that the BCTF really needs to share that example with other teachers' organizations is this concept of the BCTF of being a social justice union, of being an organization that doesn't just look for such important things as better working conditions and salaries for the membership, but looks for how it can best contribute to building a society in which there is justice and equality for everyone. That's not common in all organizations, and it's an important gift to share.
Y en muchas ocasiones nos hemos preguntado en México, ¿de dónde proviene la fuerza de una organización sindical? ¿De dónde proviene la fuerza de esta federación representada por ustedes? Proviene, por supuesto, de su organización, de su ejercicio democrático, de su liderazgo, pero también proviene de la solidaridad internacional, de la relación que ha establecido con una gran cantidad de sindicatos en el mundo y de organizaciones que tenemos conciencia de que si atacan a uno de ustedes, atacan a uno de nosotros en México. Si atacan a la Federación de Maestros de Columbia Británica, atacan a nuestras organizaciones también en México.
So often in Mexico, when we're sort of calculating how we get things done, we ask ourselves, where does our strength of our social organizations come from? What is our strength? And of course, many sources of strength can be found within labor organizations and teachers organizations. One is the level of organization there is, the democratic processes that take place so that everyone feels heard and included, the competency of the leadership, but also a section of strength comes from international solidarity, from developing the concept, the old labor concept of an internationalizing of it, that an injury to one is an injury to all. So that we feel most profoundly that when they attack the BC Teachers Federation here in Canada, they're attacking our organizations as well, and we need to act to defend them.
Y nos preguntamos también por qué la ofensiva, el ataque a nuestros sindicatos y a las maestras y a los maestros en el mundo. La respuesta es porque las corporaciones y los gobiernos nos tienen miedo, compañeros y compañeras.
And we also ask ourselves why, if it's true that there is this sort of work happening, this way international, worldwide wave of attempt to undermine public education, to undermine teachers and teachers' organizations, why would this be? Why is this taking place? And our answer is, colleagues, it's because the large corporations and the governments that no longer see public education as a value are afraid of us.
Nos tienen miedo. ¿Y por qué? ¿Por qué somos peligrosos para ellos? Somos peligrosos porque pensamos, tenemos ideas, somos críticos, transformamos, pero lo que nos vuelve más peligrosos es que enseñamos a pensar a nuestros estudiantes, que les enseñamos a indagar, a investigar, a no aceptar verdades absolutas. Esto es por lo que nos tienen miedo.
So why do they fear us? Well, they fear us because we think for ourselves, because we have ideas, that we can be critical, that we work for transformation often. But what makes us as educators most dangerous is that we teach our students to think, to carry out research, to not accept absolute truths.
Y si a esto le agregamos que defendemos nuestros derechos como trabajadores de la educación y lo hacemos en nuestro salón de clases, en nuestra escuela, en nuestra provincia, en nuestra nación, pero si lo hacemos a nivel internacional, somos más peligrosos. Por eso es tan importante la solidaridad y los vínculos que hemos creado.
And if we add to that, that in addition to teaching and working with our students and developing critical, active citizens in our classrooms, that we also defend our own rights in our classrooms, in our schools, in our provinces, in our countries, we become even more dangerous. And if we then develop links and collaboration at the international level, that's when we become a major threat to this international process.
Y esta es una de las grandes aportaciones que su federación y a nivel de sus agremiados agradecemos hacen no solo a los maestros de México de América Latina, sino de muchos millones de maestros en el mundo que hemos compartido con ustedes su generosidad y su filosofía de lo que es la justicia social. Esto es muy importante para nosotros.
And so this is something that your federation has taken a leadership role in. And the impact of the BCTF, not just in Mexico, not just in Latin America, but also among teachers' organizations around the world, affecting millions of teachers, is an incredible contribution to this struggle. And for this reason, we want to thank the example of the BCTF, of the generosity of its membership, but even more so of its example of carrying that message of a social justice union, of a organization that cares for its society around the world.
Por eso, compañeros y compañeras, brothers and sisters, les manifiesto nuestro compromiso como maestras y maestros mexicanos y de muchos otros lugares de nuestro continente para avanzar juntos en este programa de lucha que tenemos para defender la educación pública, para no aceptar recortes presupuestales ni despidos de maestros y maestras, para exigir que los impuestos se usen para la educación pública y no para fortalecer a la educación privada, para que los exámenes estandarizados se hagan a un lado, porque lo único que hacen es convertirse en un elemento de exclusión, para también continuar nuestra lucha en contra de la privatización de la educación en todos sus niveles, recuperando el sentido de lo que es ser maestro o maestra.
And so for this reason, brothers and sisters, I want to reiterate or reply, underscore our commitment as teachers, as Mexican teachers, and with our colleagues in many other of the Latin American countries at all education levels, to advance in this active solidarity to carry out this common struggle to ensure that the taxes that are collected are invested in public education and making strong, effective public education, that there's equal access for all, rather than being going into subsidizing private enterprise, private education. To struggle to eliminate this wave of standardized exams that have been imposed over the last 15, 20 years that only serve to exclude and categorize students, and to recover the sense of being a committed teacher in our public system.
Y tengan seguridad de que vamos a continuar avanzando en la construcción de esta solidaridad activa que nos fortalece recíprocamente a ustedes y a nosotros. Y como no hablo inglés, o muy poquito, quiero que Steve, antes de que concluya mi intervención en español, les diga que voy a terminar con una consigna que en mi país es muy manifiesta en las marchas de los maestros, para que lo entiendan en inglés y después yo la diga en español. Y dice: de norte a sur, de este a oeste, ganaremos esta lucha, cueste lo que cueste.
And so I look forward to continuing for our organizations to continuing working together in this common struggle for a public education that meets the needs of all sectors of our society. And because I don't speak English, I wanted to close with a common chant that we say in our marches in Mexico, but I need the help of the translator to turn it into a catchy chant in English. I'll see how I could do. The chant in Spanish is: de norte a sur, de este a oeste, ganaremos esta lucha, cueste lo que cueste.
Y dice, and, de norte a sur.
Voy a traducirlo en inglés.
No.
So first I'll tell you it in English, and then she can chant it, and you can repeat it in Spanish. But it's from north to south, from east to west, we will win this struggle no matter what the quest cost.
De norte a sur, de este a oeste, ganaremos esta lucha, cueste lo que cueste. De norte a sur, de este a oeste, ganaremos esta lucha, cueste lo que cueste.
¡Viva la lucha de los maestros de Columbia Británica!
Viva.
Long live the British Columbian teacher struggles.
Mary Luz, gracias. Thank you for your solidarity, your strong advocacy for public education and against privatization, for your stand against oppression, for your amazing role in the Tri-National. Your struggle is our struggle. It's a common collective struggle together. And our relationship and our continued involvement is so important as we move forward. And reminding us and the importance of our role and our responsibility in our society and the importance of being a strong social justice union as well. And the chant that Mary Luz ended with is just so, when I was in Mexico in November, it's just so amazing, so heartwarming to hear our sisters and brothers, our compañeros in Mexico with the chant of our collectivism. It's just so cool. And Mary Luz, again, gracias, and viva la solidaridad internacional.